Career prior to joining Norton Healthcare included serving in the positions of Executive Director of the Charlotte Regional Medical Center in Punta Gorda, Florida. Is that right, John? Punta Gorda. President and Chief Executive Officer of Columbia Suburban Hospital and President and Chief Executive Officer of the Women's Hospital in Indianapolis. Please welcome to the mic John Harriman.
Well, good afternoon. It's my pleasure today to represent our Board of Trustees, executive leadership, and more than 11,000 associates of Norton Healthcare, as we're once again proud to be a sponsor of the ninth annual Business Summit and annual meeting. All of us here today share an abiding interest in the economic health of the Commonwealth. We at Norton Healthcare know that the health and well-being of our citizens is vital to the growth and future prosperity that we all envision for Kentucky. We offer our continued commitment to furthering the goal of a healthy Kentucky. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Dr. Paul Coomes. Dr. Coomes was named Senior Economic Advisor for the Kentucky Chamber in late 2013. He provides regular economic data and trend analysis to the organization, as well as research on the economic performance of regional economies across the state. Dr. Coomes is an Emeritus Professor of Economics at the University of Louisville and a Special Consultant to the Urban Studies Institute at U of L. His area of expertise is regional economics, especially Kentucky and the Louisville region. He's been informing policy decisions through applied research in Louisville for 25 years. Please help me to welcome Dr. Coomes to the podium.
Thanks, John, Bill, everybody. Good afternoon. So you've got me in the dreaded after lunch spot. I'll try to do as well as Rand Paul did yesterday. He really jazzed everybody up. I'll give it some energy for you. So you'll see in your seat, hopefully you didn't sit on it, there's a little schematic of some of the themes I'm going to go through and try to turn this into a Q&A more than a lecture. Al Cross over here is already finished, and he's got 100% on it. I checked his work a few minutes ago. Star student that he is. And let me just, to set this up, tell you where I got this idea. I was on a KET program, actually, a TV program, probably 15 years ago with Gene Strong, who was head of the Cabinet for Economic Development, and we were talking about Kentucky's poor ranking in per capita income. And so that's an average measure, right? And I said, well, Gene, thinking about the average income in Kentucky is about like talking about the average elevation of Colorado. You know, it's the average doesn't mean a lot, does it? It's the variation that's interesting. And so that led me to think about maybe there's not just one Kentucky economy, quote unquote, but there might be these, in this case, nine regional economies. And that's what I'm going to try to sell you today as a way to think about economic development as opposed to one statewide challenge that's kind of homogeneous, right? And I'll sell you on that first, or I'll try to, and then I'll take you through a lot of measures. And I'm not going to push you to any kind of policy stuff. We can get to that with Q&A if you like. I'm mainly going to provide you a lot of trends and facts, and then you can make your own forecast, and hopefully it'll challenge you to think about policy in different ways. So that's what I'm going to try to do, and I'll start moving around now since I'm mic'd up, I believe. We good? Yeah, thank you. Excellent. They even have here, you can't see it, but they have something called a confidence monitor. I've never seen this before. Yeah. So are we good? Nope, we're not good. There we go. All right. So. Go. There we go. Now, yes, here we go. So I thought it out, started out thinking about the Kentucky area as a collection of television markets. And the reason I like this concept is television markets really don't care about political boundaries. They run on advertising and they want to reach people who might buy something from them. So therefore, you don't broadcast where you can't find customers. And so I've Googled, and guess what? Right away, you can find anything on Google. This is a map of television markets in the United States. Can you find Kentucky? Well, not really. You don't see states, do you? You don't even see cities. So we're in here somewhere. But obviously, markets really don't care about political boundaries. So if you zoom in on Kentucky's television markets, another little map I found online, you've noticed that there's actually 10 of them that contain Kentucky counties. And interestingly, most of these, really all but Lexington, and you could argue Bowling Green, are totally contained inside Kentucky. All the rest spill over state borders. So as you go around the horn, you know, you've got the big Cincinnati, Northern Kentucky market, you've got the Ashland, Huntington, Charleston, West Virginia market, et cetera, and go around. And like I say, all but a couple of them flop over the state boundary. So this gave me the idea, combined with commuting patterns, to think about the world this way. So this is a Google view of Kentucky. And in my economic geography mind, I see it this way. I see Lexington as central, right? So you got the television market. And then as you go north of there, you bump into the Northern Kentucky Cincinnati market, correct? And then as you go east, you've got the Ashland, Huntington, Charleston market, et cetera. Then there's something I'm calling mountain because there's no large cities there. It's kind of an outlier, kind of remote. We can get into the details in a minute. And then the Somerset, Cumberland, I think that's sort of separate than the deep mountain market. You've got the Bowling Green, Hopkinsville market, which kind of leans towards Nashville and gets a lot of Nashville stations. You've got the Paducah Purchase market. You've got the Owensboro, Henderson, Evansville market. And then you've got the Louisville, Elizabethtown, Southern Indiana market. And notice how these Venn diagrams overlap, so it gets kind of ambiguous when you get the intersections. But the TV markets and the commuting patterns markets line up pretty well. And so I'm locking it in this way, the map that I showed you at the beginning on the front slide and is also on your handout. So what I'll do for most of the rest of the next 20 minutes or so is to go through different measures about these and get you thinking about their different characteristics, their different economic opportunities and challenges, right? And hopefully I'll tell you some things you hadn't thought of. So let me just start off with one state level thing. The rest of it's all gonna be regional. Do you know Kentucky's rank in 1958 in terms of earned per capita income? So by earned, I mean we take out government transfer payments and just look at how much wages and salaries, business income, dividends, interest, rent, those kind of things. Everything except transfers. Where Kentucky ranked among states, and I'll give you four choices here. And what do you think it is? Oh, you're very, very good, 46th. Thank goodness for Mississippi, West Virginia, Arkansas. Yeah, so it's 46th. And I'll show you the long-term answer here. And you might be shocked to know that last year, we're still 46th. So, you know, after all of these billions of dollars of investments in infrastructure, education, da-da-da, over several generations, really, we really have not moved one rank on net since 1958. So I think we need to ask ourselves, maybe we might want to change some of our policies if we're not passing other states. All right, so now let me go to the regions and sort of differentiate them for you and then get into some of the interesting measures. So which one do you think is the most densely populated? Boy, you guys are good, A+. Northern Kentucky. So here's the actual data. You can download these slides later because I'm gonna throw a ton of data at you. You're not gonna be able to digest half of what I'm throwing at you, although you're doing pretty well so far. You can see that the Northern Kentucky and Louisville regions dramatically more dense than the others and about three times more dense than the least populated areas. And to me, that has great implications for delivering public services, for economic efficiency, for wages, productivity, everything else. But I mean, the great example, simplest example would be schools. If you've got to pick up all these kids, you know, let's say 1,000 kids in a school district, it's a lot easier to pick up, you know, one kid per block than it is one kid per 6 miles, right? So it has a lot of implications for the expense of doing things and how costly it is to subsidize rural things. And here's the most dense counties, and they're 30 times more dense than the least dense counties. So that's what we've got in Kentucky, dramatic difference in density. All right. Which of the nine regions has had the least population growth This is 2000 to 2013. Okay. Boy, you guys are 100% so far. That's what you had right out? Yep. Mountain. Now, we're going to delve into this now a little more. So, actually, the mountain region lost population this decade. What is that, 4,500 on net? And Louisville, Lexington, growing. And what the theme you're going to see here for the next 20 minutes is the tails of the state have been shrinking economically and demographically, and the center of the state has had the growth. So basically, the north-south corridor along and between Interstate 65 and 75 has been almost all the growth in the state, really, for a couple decades, right? Here it is in percentage terms. So you can see, even when you account for the fact that Louisville is by far the most populated region, it still had pretty strong percentage growth, 2.2%. And while the Mountain, Ashland, and Paducah, the tails of the state, have been shrinking. And then if you look in terms of births and deaths, so this is what demographers call natural growth in the population, the tails have had more deaths than births. So it's not just migration, the fact that people aren't moving there, it's also people aren't replacing themselves in the tails. Right? Now, let's go back to the earliest data I have in my data set, 1969, and look at 44 years of population growth, just so you get a bigger picture than just this decade. Notice the blue bar shows you the population of the regions in 1969. The green shows you the growth since then, okay? So you can see the biggest green bar, I guess, would be the Lexington area. The center of the state has had the most growth in sheer numbers. And notice what's happening here. These smaller, less populated regions have 28 counties. Combined, they have less population than Jefferson County. So that's how differentiated the economic development challenge is in Kentucky. And then look at the Mountain region. It's been losing population. It used to be the third most populated region. It's now fifth, and it'll be seventh in a few years. So it's really shrinking demographically. People are moving out. I've got another one here. This shows you the whole history of the Mountain region. You can see that they peaked at 408,000, and they've lost 76,000 people in the last two decades. So it's depopulating pretty rapidly. The one next to it, Cumberland, has actually picked up almost 50,000. So a lot of people from the deep mountains have moved more over towards I-75, where there's more economic opportunity. That's what that tells me. Ashland's been pretty dead flat. The rest of the regions, except for Paducah, Purchase, have been growing. Now let's switch, and I'll just ask you four or five industrial structure questions just to make sure you understand what the specialties are out there. So let's take agriculture first. Which one do you think has the highest income? This is wages and salaries, but it's also business proprietor income. So if you own a farm, you get your self-employment income. What do you think the answer is there? What'd you say? Oh, you're all over the place. Good. What was your answer, Al? It does count horses. Boy, this guy's good. So this is kind of a trick question, because horse equine is counted in agriculture, and the net income from that can be huge. And here's the look of it. As you can see, Lexington, 255 million average income. I had to average it over a bunch of years because it goes up and down like crazy from year to year depending upon horse sales. But it's okay. This basically gives you the pattern. And then you can see Bowling Green, Hopkinsville, you've got a lot of corn down there, hog operations, chicken operations, cattle-calf operations, and then the Owensboro-Henderson area, which, if you know that area, there's a lot of bottom land, a lot of soybeans, corn, tobacco, through all of those. So those are your three, and there's your bottom line. Across all regions of the state, it's about $1.1 billion. And that sounds like a lot of money, except that we're about a $110 billion economy. It's really only 1% of the state total, okay? So we talk a lot about it, and it is important, and it does bring money into the state, but it's still, in direct terms, only 1%. All right, let's switch to mining, another one we've been spending a lot of time talking about today. Which one? You all know the answer to this. Mount. Yeah. So that one's an easy one. And dramatically, right? So you've got these two. Owensboro Henderson, of course, includes, Mike Duncan was talking about, Muhlenberg County. There's a lot of coal mining south of Owensboro Henderson that goes in there, and there's a lot of oil and gas in both of these, and they collectively account for 75% of the total. But having said that, combine all of the income from these two industries, it's $2.2 billion, which is still only 2% of the total income in the state. So combine all of agriculture, including horses, tobacco, corn, cattle, all that, and all of mining, coal, oil, and gas, and you're still up only 3% of the income in the state. So we spent a lot of time talking about that 3%, I think. All right, what about manufacturing? Yeah, I hear the rumbling, Louisville. Okay, you're right, it is Louisville. And it's Louisville, then Lexington, and then the Bowling Green-Hopkinsville area. Just the so-called beam region that the two mayors have been talking about, the Louisville-Lexington economies, 58% of the state total. But now we're talking about real money. We're talking about almost $16 billion in income, mainly wages and salaries in manufacturing, and it is 14% of the income in the state. Again, concentrated down Interstate 65 and 75, your assembly plants, your parts plants that we've seen for 30 years, right? And had somewhat of a comeback. All right, what about distribution industry? So now we're talking about warehousing and transportation, basically, logistics. Okay, I heard the rumbling. It's Louisville again, and that's true. And by far, you know, this is UPS, and then everything around all these industrial parks and all those logistics centers out in Bullitt County, and it's huge, and it is, do I have the number here for the total? Yes, I do. It amounts to 5%. Of labor and proprietor's income in the state. So just warehousing and trucking and other transportation is more than all of agriculture and mining combined. And it's increasingly so. This is a booming industry. Kentucky is very fortunate. Our location is probably our best advantage. Central location, you know, the famous one day's truck drive. You can get, 600 miles or something. And it's something like 65% of the US population you can get to in a day. And that's our great advantage. It's a great advantage for our trade shows and conventions too, because people can drive here without taking an airplane and get here cheaply. So Louisville's 44% of the state total. Office industries, and here I picked up the sector called professional scientific and business services, which is your higher end professional industries that have to take place mainly in offices. So it's lawyers and accountants, but it's also research firms, advertising firms, PR firms, architectural firms, engineering firms, jobs that pay on average, you know, $80,000 a year and require a professional degree. And of course, you already know the answer, don't you? Louisville again. I don't mean to beat it to death, but these, in economic development world, you all know this, you think of the world in terms of manufacturing, distribution, and office. That's what you study when you get into economic development. That's who you're trying to lure, because those are the ones that are competitive and mobile, right? So I had to take you through those. And there's the answer. Louisville accounts for 46% of the state total, and the triangle, Lexington, Northern Kentucky, Louisville, account for almost 80% of the state total. So that's where your offices are, and it's about 5% of the state. Strongest job growth since the bottom of the recession. Dave asked me to look at this in the spring, and we put out a press release a couple of months ago on this to look at how we've come back out of the recession here. Which one of these do you think has had the strongest since basically July of 2009 through the end of 2013? This is percentage job growth. It's not Louisville, I'll tell you that. Oh, actually, I didn't put Louisville on the list, did I? Hint, hint. It's not. Bowling Green's doing well, but it's actually Lexington. Let's see, there you go. That's the highest of the nine regions, Lexington. Louisville's done pretty well. Bowling Green, Hopkinsville's done well. The blue line is total all industry jobs. I'm giving you a lot of information on one slide. You'll have to go back to the privacy of your office and study this carefully, but the red or reddish bar is manufacturing. So this is really good news, this number here, the 22% strong growth in manufacturing in the Louisville region. So this is GE and Ford coming back and all of their suppliers adding a lot of employment and, you know, reinvesting in those plants. The bottom left hand, there's a really bad story. The mountain region losing 5% more jobs since the recession. So this is the flight out of people because there's no jobs.
Yep.
Please? Oh, unallocated. Don't pay too much attention to that. There were a few counties that they wouldn't disclose the number because it would give away an individual company's employment numbers. You could guess, and there's confidentiality laws, and the federal government won't let you show it. I mean, we're talking about a few hundred jobs, but I just wanted, for completeness, I wanted to show you all the results. So it's irrelevant to the story. I should have just dropped it, probably. This is wages and salaries. I'll just jump through this. You can read it when you get back to your office. Instead of jobs, this is payroll, basically. I don't have time to get into all of that. All right. Which region has the largest private industry payroll in the state? So this is non-government, basically. So it's going to be Louisville again. And this is the payroll per capita, okay? So you can see Louisville by far and Northern Kentucky have the highest payroll per capita. So they're dense, they're urban. You'll have most of your higher-end office jobs there, a lot of high-end manufacturing jobs there, and the ones that pay little per capita are rural and sparse. We used to say wealthy and poor. I like to put it more in terms of dense versus sparse, because density really matters in economics and in productivity and wages. There's just a pie chart that takes you through where the private sector is in the state. This is one of my favorite little tables, if you'll bear with me. I looked at the counties in terms of the most private sector earnings in the state, and you can see, you know, there's Jefferson, and you can take four counties in Kentucky and you account for half of all private sector payrolls. So it's Jefferson, Fayette, Boone, and Kenton. So there's your tax base. Half your tax base is in four counties. This is what we're dealing with, right? And notice, out of the top 10, every one of them, except maybe Scott County, are urban. So we tend to forget this, particularly in Frankfurt, when we get all gummed up in all these rural arguments. Most of the economic activity are in your top cities, right? And we don't treat them very well, in my opinion. Okay, now let's go to government. Here's a trick one. Let's see who gets this one right. I didn't check Al's answer on this. So which one has the highest government payroll per capita? What's that? Nobody feels strongly? It does include military. Good guess. That's the trick part of it. So it includes federal. We'll get to the state part, but yeah. So you're right. You said Hopkinsville, Bowling Green, somebody did. You're right. And that's because of Fort Campbell. Fort Campbell gets counted down there, even though most of the base is on the Tennessee side and most of the employees live on the Tennessee side. The payroll gets counted in Kentucky and in Christian County. And then notice the way that goes, too. The second one is Lexington, which includes Frankfurt region, Frankfurt area, and then Fort Knox is in the Louisville-Elizabethtown area. So now let's go to more of a county breakout and look at the rest of the story, which really gets down to the state and local expenditures, particularly how big government is in some of these counties. Once you take out the military operations, Christian and Hardin, and take out Franklin, which is home to state government, and then you got the state penitentiary in Lyon County, which, you know, very lightly populated county, all other eight are in eastern Kentucky, where government is, you know, the biggest share of economic activity. Okay, and now that leads to transfer payments. Sorry for the geeky term in economics. That just means you're being provided with some income, either cash or some kind of in-kind benefits for which you do nothing in return. It's a transfer. It'd be like if you retire, you get Social Security payment, okay? But this includes all kinds of other things, workman's comp, SSI, you know, supplemental income, food stamps, disability payments, unemployment insurance, all of these sort of mainly government transfer payments. And you sort of, yeah, I'm sure you already know the answer of which has the highest per capita. It's going to be Mountain, and it is it's pretty dramatic. So you've got $11,600 per capita in transfer payments going into the Mountain region, and Cumberland right behind it, over $10,000 in the Ashland. How much is that of their total personal income? Well, in the Mountain region, 40% of personal income is from transfer payments. Isn't that wild? See, the national average is I think, 10%. So it's 38% there, 17% in Northern Kentucky. Let me skip through this. This is too geeky. You can read it at home. This one's interesting. This is transfer payments as a share of the total income in the county, and this is all 120 counties. And so we start with three counties where over half of personal income in that county is from transfer payments, primarily government transfer payments. This is incredible. After 50 years of poverty programs that obviously didn't work, we have 23 counties of 40% or higher. National average is 17%. So almost all Kentucky counties are way above average. So we might want to think about some different economic development policies, or else we'll look at this 10, 20 years from now and it'll look the same. Because this is pretty much what it looked like 30 years ago. Yep. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Questions later, Al.
The three counties aren't Owsley, Clay, and Brenton. Those are just interstices. What are the bottom three?
I'm glad you asked that question. I thought I had it on the next slide. I may have pulled it just to make this less geeky. They're almost all in eastern Kentucky. I had a table, I may have dropped it, that shows the top counties. Hold that thought, I may still have it in the slide deck, but they're almost, well, I think of the 23 counties, 40% or higher, I would say they're all in eastern Kentucky. Yeah, I didn't have room to put all the county names on here. Good point. Which has the highest rate of disabilities among working adults? This gets at the transfer payment, what's driving it, and you know the answer. There you go. So Mountain, almost 29% of working age adults tell the Census Bureau that they have a disability that limits their ability to work. Cumberland next. Here we go. Al, this is close. This will line up with the transfer payments. I listed the first five. And the top 18 counties are in eastern Kentucky. Okay, which region has the highest rate of high school graduates? Lexington would be a good guess, but it's wrong. It's actually Northern Kentucky. And it's only by a hair. You can see Northern Kentucky there. And then Louisville second, Paducah, Lexington. All pretty good. And there's your sort of state average across there. You can see, what is we got? Five of them above and four of them below. And now, how about college? Now you've got the answer correct. Yeah, Lexington. Lexington by far has the highest rate of college, and part of that is because, you know, the University of Kentucky has by far the most graduate programs in the state, so you get a lot of people there with master's degrees, graduate students working on PhDs, living there, it helps their workforce, et cetera, and there's the way it looks. Lexington, Northern Kentucky, Louisville leading the way, and those are the only three above the state average. Probably not real surprising to you. All right, so I think this is my last, this is my wind up here, and I'll turn it over to Dave. So which county in Kentucky has the largest land area? This is a little loaded question. What? God, how do you know this stuff? I'm gonna make this test harder next year. Al had it penciled in right away. You're Kentucky students. It is Pike. But I'll bet you don't know where I'm going with this. So famous 120 county issue. Let's talk about that a minute. And this is the only policy thing I'll get into unless you ask me some juicy questions. So everybody knows the story, right? Why we have 120 counties. Because when they drew the lines, that they wanted to make sure that everybody in the state could get to the government center and do their public business in one day's horse ride round trip. So that's, if you go to the Encyclopedia of Kentucky and look up counties, you'll see my friend John Cleaver has this entry in there, and so it's true, right? And so here is Pike County, and there's a blow up of it. And so it is 788 square miles, which is about twice as big as the average county. It's huge. And so I decided to look at the distance to Pikeville from this extreme spot over here, Majestic, which is over here on the border, and calculate how long it probably took somebody if they took a horse 4 miles an hour to get to Pikeville and back. And my guess is it would take about, it would take, for Majestic, it would take about 16 hours. It'd take a long day. You'd want to go in the summertime so it didn't get dark before you got back. So that's the biggest county. The average county is 330 square miles. So if you took a horse at that speed, you could do business in 5 or 6 hours, right? So this is how we sort of set up our state government and our county government system. And we have by far the most counties per square mile of any state in the country, set 200 years ago. All right, so ask yourself, now if you were to spend 5 or 6 hours in a car today, how big of a service territory could you have for delivering the same services, right? It's a legitimate question to ask. So if you do average 45 miles an hour over that time period, 3 hours each way, you would have 135 miles. If it's a round region, just do the area of a circle, and you'll get 57,000 square miles, which turns out to be bigger than the state of Kentucky. Kentucky's only 44,000 square miles. So today's technology would allow someone to travel for business over a range as big as the state as opposed to the county. Not that we want to, you know, only have one government center, but it does ask, beg the question, why do we have 120 government centers when the technology allows people to travel, you know, 10 times faster? And so I looked at the largest region, which is Lexington, and it has 26 counties and 6,800 square miles. And so you could do this whole thing back and forth and do your business in 4 hours for one economic region. So this I'll just leave it with this kind of hanging policy question. You know, why have we not reformed our Constitution to reflect this tremendous technological change in transportation? The cost of transportation is, you know, one-tenth of what it was when we set the counties up. You know the old joke about Virginia has bigger counties than Kentucky? We were formed from Virginia, right? But their counties are bigger. And I once asked a fellow we were recruiting at University of Louisville for a faculty position why that was true. He was from Virginia, University of Virginia. And he said, well, we have faster horses. So anyway, I've heard people laugh about this since I came back from Texas, but we've never done anything about it. And I'm just a number-crunching, logical kind of person. And my thought is we could have a lot more efficient public service delivery for things like your motor vehicle, your car transfer, your jail, your PVA office, et cetera, if we combine several of these counties that only have 8,000 or 10,000 population and put the government center next to the Walmart that everybody goes to anyway, right? And of course, I don't think it's gonna happen voluntarily because there's a lot of people have vested interest in status quo, but we've tossed around the idea of maybe having an upfront cash reward for combining service districts. And don't eliminate the counties, right? We still want them to be of historical interest, like in Ireland or something. County Menifee, go visit or whatever. But for delivery of services. So you dangle a few million dollars out for the merger of these service territories, and guess what, everybody take it, and then you wouldn't make your money back for a few years, but over decades, you would save billions of dollars in administrative costs for this efficiency. So I don't know if I used up, I wasn't paying attention to the time. Are we doing okay, Dave?
Yeah.
Okay, are you up next?
Questions.
Yeah, questions, uh-oh. This is where it gets fun. Come on. Oh, that's right. You've been seeding all the questions. You're probably tired of it. You're good.
I'm tired of you bragging on Al Cross so much. No, seriously, you've got all of this information.
Yeah.
What are you going to do with it?
Well, you know, you learn a long time ago in academia to try to keep your mouth shut about policy. We're supposed to objectively analyze things and provide, you know, really a clean, thoughtful, unbiased information to people who do stuff with it. So I just try to provide facts that are provocative and maybe things you didn't know, and it's really your job, and I stay out of the policy business unless you want to take me to lunch and I'll give you my opinion. you know, but I think my main point I'm trying to get across today is we were 46th in 1958. We're 46th last year in per capita income. So obviously we've not moved the needle in a couple generations. So we might want to think about doing things differently. That's my main point, you know. Throwing money at school districts, road systems where nobody lives. Our economic development policy, now I'm going to give them my opinion. You knew it was coming. Seems to me much of our economic development policy in the state has been redistribution. You know, we think that's the way you get ahead is redistribute. No, it's not the way most places get ahead. You get ahead through enterprise, right? And we need to get back on that track. Redistribution has not moved us up, but we're there sitting there with Mississippi and West Virginia just like we were in the 50s. While Indiana has zoomed in the past decade, Tennessee passed us by, so we're sort of sandwiched in between more progressive, faster growing, more business-friendly states. Matt's got one. Yep.
As an economist, what do you think is the number one economic thing we could do going forward to ensure that 56 years from now we're not still 46?
Yeah.
One thing.
One. Well, that's a tough one. One thing. Yeah. In my mind, the state government has, you know, a legitimate role at providing things maybe local governments aren't very efficient at doing, like highways. You don't want to have the city of Louisville build a highway that's 12 feet wide, meeting a highway coming from Lexington that's 6 feet wide. You know, you need some coordination of that. And you also need the scale of 4.5 million people to provide a research university, et cetera. So those are legitimate state-level functions. But I think Kentucky's gone way too far in providing local public services through state government. I mean, it's gotten so bad, I know there's been all these budget shortfalls, but in most of my adult lifetime living in Kentucky, it felt like if you wanted to get a new baseball field for your Little League program, anywhere in the state, you needed a meeting with the governor. You know, if you want sidewalks, if you want a water system, a sewer system, an industrial park, you know, it was the state's responsibility. Well, I think we tried that model, and this is what you get. I'm in favor of local option sales taxes, for example, to reverse the, and I'm also in favor of lowering the state income tax at the same time, and devolve this responsibility back to the local governments that are closer to the voters, who can decide, well, we're Owensboro, or we're Henderson, or we're Paducah, or we're Ashland, or we're Somerset, or Pikeville, we like this kind of community, and we want these kind of public services, and we're willing to pay for them with a local sales tax. And if somebody comes up with an idea and puts it on the ballot and it fails, that says the people don't want to pay for it. And that's the way most of the rest of the country works, is referendum. And then you get a big variety of different public service mixtures around the state, and then it's more attuned to the economy, and they grow. And put a fork in this era of the state government providing every convention center, every museum, every park, every recreational facility in the state. The one size fits all. We're like Cuba here, you know? And you see what we get. So that would be the biggest thing, and that's why I'm for the local option sales tax at the same time that we reduce the state income tax. Our income tax, you know, 6% that you hit at 75,000, it's almost 8%. It's almost 6% at, $8,000 compared to Indiana. Indiana has a 3.4% flat tax, which is much better than our schedule. And then, of course, Tennessee has no state income tax on wages and salaries. So we need that. Personally, I think that would be the biggest single thing we could do to make, we would get an immediate headline in the Wall Street Journal if Kentucky were to cut its income tax in half, its income tax rate in half. And it would be like open for business. It just changes the whole dynamic and the view of Kentucky as a place to do business, in my view. And I don't see anybody doing it, but I support anybody who would propose it. Ernie Fletcher tried and got nowhere. He was hammered by the state legislature, and I think he got it down to 5.7% for some break, and then it was up to 6% by 75,000. That's as far as we got the last time it was tried. But see, at the same time that you switch from lowering the income tax to having a local sales tax, local option sales tax, like Tennessee does and most places do, communities have to take more responsibility for the public services. There's no free lunch. So you get the state out of the business of a lot of these local public services, but then the local governments have to get in the business. Yeah.
I actually agree with you on the what you just said about the income tax. I'm here at the mic. I just want to sit down here in a minute. I just want to point out, you mentioned schools just a minute ago. We have 174 school districts in the state of Kentucky. In Northern Kentucky, we have 18. Two of them are less than 300 kids in each school district. We have one school district that has 20,000 kids and two that have less than 250 kids. And in Boone, Kent, and Campbell County, we have 38 forms of government. Think about that, 38 forms of government in what would be one city typically. And the problem from my perspective in both schools and cities and the counties consolidating is that the state is set up to penalize when that happens. In fact, they don't have a system to do it right. Because the way the SEEK formula is set up, if you get a really poor school district that's not performing well to merge in with a bigger school district, the bigger school district's penalized. So I think our state government needs to wake up and talk about these consolidations and make some policy changes so that we can have a better place to live, work, and play. Thanks.
Yeah, I agree with you. I'll go one step further. You said there's 174 school districts. I think 100 of them generate less than a fourth of their own budget. Out of 174 school districts, 100 generate less than 25% of their own budget. So when CARA was passed and implemented in 1990, the idea was we have a lot of poor school districts, they can't afford to put on a good school system, so we're gonna redistribute money, subsidize those, and invest in human capital and infrastructure there to improve the labor force that would give them a chance for prosperity. That was the concept 30-something years ago. Well, here we are in 2014, and the same redistribution is occurring, and I don't see the communities booming. And I also don't see much responsibility for local finance. I mean, it's set up so that it will go on forever, this entitlement program of getting a free school, basically, for most school districts in the state. I would argue that if you want to get the SEEK money, you should have to have a local occupational tax. You know, the argument is we need huge state subsidies to pay for our schools forever because we don't have a property tax or we don't have a property base. That's the argument. Well, you may not have a property tax base because you don't have a UPS or something, but you do have employed people in this county that are not paying an occupational tax. In Jefferson County, our occupational tax is 3/4 of 1%. It's a gigantic share of the budget for Jefferson County schools. It's 3/4 of 1%. Payroll tax, boom, right to them. Fayette County is 0.5%. Northern Kentucky's got a couple school districts that have an occupational, there's only 8 in the whole state that have an occupational tax. I would argue that who benefits from the local schools the most? The local community. They should be willing to put up 0.5% occupational tax for the privilege of getting the state subsidy that they get every year up through the SEEK formula. It sounds cold and cruel, but it's very logical to me. The community there benefits the most. They should be willing to take a little piece of the local payroll to support their schools, like several of the cities do. But you know, they're not going to volunteer to do that. okay.
That's it.
Okay, Bill.
I know all of you will join me in thanking Paul. He's agreed to stay here till midnight, by the way, to see each of you individually. But really, if you go back to your communities, your Rotary clubs, your chamber meetings, I'm sure that Paul now, since he's not working full time, he's a professor emeritus. This is the kind of information I think every community, every government in a small town or city or big urban area needs. I think our state legislators, all of them need this kind of information. And then the question is, what are you going to do with it? Paul, I think it's a great report. Thank you for your presentation. It's my pleasure now to introduce someone who's going to introduce. Our next speaker is Scott Casey from UPS, who is this session's sponsor. Scott is the Vice President for UPS Air Group Legal and Public Affairs, and in his role, he is responsible for managing all legal affairs matters and building strong cooperative government partnerships for the airline. Scott serves on the board of directors for the Kentucky Chamber. Scott, welcome to the microphone.
Thank you, Bill. On behalf of the more than 24,000 UPS employees in the Commonwealth, good afternoon and thank you. I will keep this brief, but I did want to mention a couple of important points about UPS's economic impact and its commitment to education. Kentucky continues to be a fantastic home to our international all points hub here at Worldport, and that operation has had an important economic impact in our community. Specifically, we employ thousands of UPSers here at Worldport, but we also have been able to leverage our presence here in working in partnership with the government and others to attract more than 150 companies who have relocated to this area to have access to Worldport. Thank you. Thank you. Worldport has had an educational impact on our state as well, and as I'm sure everybody knows, UPS is a strong advocate for outstanding education. Thousands of students from more than 100 Kentucky counties, maybe I shouldn't mention that number after the conversation we just had, more than 100 counties, have participated in our Metropolitan College program, which is partially funded by the state, and it allows students to work at night at Worldport in exchange for free tuition and at the University of Louisville or Jefferson Community and Technical College. The program, Metropolitan College, has been a win-win for everyone involved. As UPS gets a motivated workforce, our youth get the chance to earn degrees, and Kentucky eventually gets citizens who are both educated and prepared to work in a professional environment when they graduate. Now it is my pleasure to introduce the Kentucky Chamber's president and CEO, Dave Atkison. Dave is entering his 10th year as president of the Kentucky Chamber. Those of you from Western Kentucky may remember him as the mayor of Owensboro. He also led both the Owensboro Chamber of Commerce and the Birmingham Chamber. On a personal note, I have learned important lessons from Dave about leadership, economic development, and a host of other things during my tenure on the board of directors of the Kentucky Chamber. I am proud to call him a business partner to UPS and a friend. Please join me in welcoming Dave Atkison.
Scott thinks. Scott, thanks very much. It's great to have companies like UPS in our state, and I'm going to come back to that in just a minute. I decided to take my coat off because it gets a little warm up here. Plus, last night I got my feelings hurt. You know, after the banquet, everybody was pretty, you know, happy and talking about our speaker and all, and I went out into the foyer, and a friend of mine, good friend, said, "Dave, I wouldn't wear that suit anymore." I had on a pinstripe suit, typical boring man's suit, and she said that under the lights on the screen, you look like a pimp. That's what my good friends are saying. Elizabeth, I'm in trouble, that's right. I bet I could have bid off my jacket to several people in this room because I noticed the temperature's been a little rough on some folks today, but hopefully they've got that under control. Thanks to Paul, you know, what an interesting guy, and his data is very compelling for the state of Kentucky. And that's why we decided to bring him on board at the chamber, because nobody was really interpreting this regional stuff. Everybody talked about the unemployment rate is 6.7. What does that mean? Doesn't mean a lot in the East compared to Louisville, compared to the West. So we wanted to start to do a little bit more of a deep dive into what really affects people's lives and their families and whether or not they can have a Christmas back in their hometowns. I'm going to talk, and by the way, they asked me to have this little segment in the program to talk about a couple of things that we're involved in. And let's see, where's the clicker? Right here. And I had to commit to the topic like 2 or 3 months ago. I said, okay, top issues facing the next governor. I thought that would help kind of get the chambers, some of our priorities into the conversation about the governor's race. And so that's what we ended up with. What I'd like to do, though, is to take a look past, certainly past this Senate race that we're all involved in right now and hearing about, past the next legislative session, past the governor's race next year, and into the next 3 to 5 years of where this state is going. And I'm not clicking, so what have I done wrong? Oh, there it is. Am I doing that? Okay. I got the power. All right, so we're gonna look, what's the future for Kentucky? What's it gonna look like? And that's kind of tough when you start to try to be specific. We can talk about general things pretty easily, and we got some of that. Ted Abernathy did such a terrific job yesterday kind of looking into the future, but I'm going to try to be a little bit more specific. I want to start with a story, and this was told to me by a friend of mine who used to be the president of the Louisville Chamber, and this was back in the 70s. He's still active, or Charles Hurd, some of you know him, still lives in Louisville, wonderful gentleman in his 90s. And I've mentioned this to him before, and he doesn't remember telling me the story, but he told me this story, and it meant a lot to me. And it was the difference between chess and horseshoes. And he made the comment that growing a community, and for our discussion this afternoon, growing the state, is more like chess than it is horseshoes. For example, in chess, you got all these different pieces. The rook, the bishop, the pawn, the queen, the king, and they have their own moves that they can make. And timing is important, and more importantly, you have to think 2 and 3 moves ahead. So for example, one of those pieces might be called transportation, one of them might be education, one of them might be tourism, one of them might be agriculture. And as you grow your community or grow your state, you have to think about what can we move. Now in horseshoes, it's a little bit easier. You rear back, you're at a family picnic, you rear back and you throw it. And if you get a ringer, you get what, 3 points? And if you get closest, you get 1 point, right? Pretty simple game, anybody steps up and does it. And a lot of times I think we have a temptation to think that solving the problems of our community or our state are like playing horseshoes. We'll elect so-and-so and he'll fix this. Or we'll get another Toyota and it'll be fine. We look at transformational events and think, oh, we just need something that'll fix us. Where in fact, it's a bunch of moves every day, all of us in the trenches working to make the right moves and think ahead and make our moves, what I like to call aggressive incrementalism. How's that for a 50-cent term? Aggressive incrementalism. We gotta keep plugging. Occasionally there will be transformational events. Recently I did a survey of about 50 friends and colleagues, Al Cross, some other journalists, Jim Ramsey at U of L and some university presidents, some other people that I just picked out of my emails, and said, tell me in your lifetime what you consider some of the transformational events. And I got a flood of answers. Al Smith, remember him from KET? Al gave me like three volumes. In 1935, Clements got elected and that destroyed the FDR, New Deal, you know, a bunch of stuff. But the top four things that came out of transformational events, now this is back to horseshoes, where you do one thing and it's a big deal and it transforms your state. Transformational events, one, Patton's higher education reform of 1997, which created the Kentucky Community and Technical College system. Now this was not scientific, and I might have asked one too many higher education folks, but that's what, right tied with it was Rose versus the Council of Better Education, which led to CARA and a tax increase, and this state attempted to jumpstart its education. Toyota, 1985, and the growth of over 100 plants that came here because Toyota came here. And fourth, Scott Casey, was UPS and the growth of logistics industries. Now, there were like two pages of answers. I'm not sure what I'm going to do. I'll probably write an article or something to try to sum them up. But other things like the state park system, integration of the public schools, toll road system, first female governor, Governor Collins was mentioned. You know, those types of things that people consider transformational events. Let me mention just real briefly, because Ted Abernathy did such a terrific job yesterday, I don't want to plow back the ground he's already plowed, but just to mention some of the trends that I think all of us in this room would agree are affecting us, our world, and our state. What is this? This is my lovely wife, Bonnie. I won't tell you the age cohort that she is in, because it would be unfair. She's not in this room. We were celebrating our 38th anniversary. Can you tell what that is? Huh? Rolling Stones concert, exactly. 2 weeks after this event, Mick Jagger turned 70. There are over 30,000 people in this thing, in this arena. By the way, Patrick, they were playing hockey the night before in this arena and the night after they were playing hockey too. But they set it up for the Rolling Stones, and you can tell I bought really good tickets. Bonnie said, did binoculars come with these tickets? No, the reason I show this slide, though, is that there are about 30,000 baby boomers in there. If y'all want to see my T-shirt from the concert tour, got it on it. No, there are about 30,000, and in 10 years, all of them will be retired and out of the workforce. I just announced my retirement, by the way, Elizabeth, right there. No, really, seriously, these baby boomers are retiring at 10,000 per day in this country. Huge implications for our workforce. So the skills gap that we have right now is only going to get worse because boomers are going to the beach and the economy's recovering and you're getting more jobs created. So it's only going to get worse. So aging population, we all agree on that. Jobs, skills, mismatch. We have too many people without jobs and we have too many jobs without people. And we've heard about that the last day and a half. Limited public resources, the state government is not going to have any money for the foreseeable future. They just balanced a budget. That was great. It was a fairly responsible budget, but it ignored the fact that the teacher's retirement system needs $400 million more. Just ignored it. And how do you do it? That's 4%. You could pass gaming tomorrow and it wouldn't cover that bill. So we got real problems in the federal government. You know the situation. We're spending more than we have. We published this leaky bucket report, which chronicled the situation in Kentucky. Globalization. For every one of us, there's 100 more out there that'll work for a dollar an hour and do either our jobs or part of our jobs. And that's not going to change in our lifetimes that I can tell. It's really, really profound. Urbanization, take a look at this shot. Does anybody recognize this? This is Shanghai, China. Some of you have been to China. You're looking from the Bund, which was the old European section, across the river toward, what do they call it? I've forgotten. Pudong, that's right, Pudong. Fairly rural, I mean undeveloped, relatively undeveloped. That was 1990, 20 years later, only 20 years later, look at that, urbanization. And it's not just Shanghai, it is people from Knott County moving to Lexington, and it's people from LaRue County moving to Louisville, and Ohio County moving to Owensboro. Rapid technological change, all of us realize that. I was thinking one day, I wish I kept track of this, it'd be interesting to document this, that every day all of us would have to adapt to some new technological, put a new app on your phone, figure out something in your new car, GPS, whatever, almost one a day to just kind of keep up. And that's not a techie, that's just trying to keep up. Knowledge-based growth, used to the, you know, as it's been said, people went to jobs, now jobs are going to people. Jobs follow people. So what do we do about it? Three things that I'm going to suggest today. One is to create a culture of competitiveness. And you say, well, you know, a state is a state. What's a culture of competitiveness mean? Well, if you go to UK or U of L basketball, there is a culture of competitiveness. You go to Alabama football, there's a culture of competitiveness. And states are not all the same. We've got to create that culture. We need to enact a pro-growth tax code. Everybody seems to be for comprehensive tax reform. We are too, but you break it down and everybody has a different opinion. But we're a porous state. We have seven or eight other states bordering us, and hundreds of decisions are being made by business people and families and young professionals every day about where they're going to do business, locate things, put a new warehouse, that sort of thing. And so we are very, very vulnerable to tax codes, and trying to do one size fits all in Frankfurt doesn't necessarily help Hopkinsville versus Ashland and all that. Governor Beshear announced a proposal late in the session, basically said, you know, he didn't expect it to be voted on this last session. We felt like it was a move in the right direction, and it did involve a little new revenue. Build economic development strategies based on regions. This is a set of paintings in our conference room at the office. We had an artist do 10 regional paintings of commerce, and it gets back to what Paul just said about his, this is 10 regions, he does 9, he's more scientific, but it's the same concept. We need to talk about right to work. These are some friends in our labor movement. We're talking after a hearing in Frankfurt. That's an issue our state needs to deal with. Indiana's done it. All the states to the south of us, where most of our competition is, we've got to deal. It's a very emotional issue and usually starts out with emotion rather than facts. We need to recruit talent. As I mentioned, jobs tend to follow people and follow talent. What if we, as a state, and by the way, I asked Jessica to put a slide in here to represent student debt. She said, could I use a selfie? but she's paid hers off now, so that didn't qualify. But this is a beleaguered student, average student with financial debt, $30,000 when they graduate, $30,000, average. And so what if we were the first state to offer a tax credit to employers who helped their new employees with student debt? What if we said, we're open for business, we're going to buy talent. We were going to want to bring young people into this state, and that's how we, one method. You know, we recruit industries. What if we started to shift some of those resources to buying talent? Escalate international trade. This is my friend Lynn Parrish. Is Lynn in the audience? He was here earlier. There's Lynn, standing in front of a Texas Roadhouse. The thing that's unique about this is that it's one of the top stores in the world for sales. It's in Dubai. Louisville company doing business all over the world. And we ship agricultural products all over the world. We need to do more. Dr. Will Snell, who's here from UK, did a study, showed that other states have concentrated departments working on international sales in agriculture. We need a more focused effort. And that's not to blame anybody, it's just that it's kind of spread all over state government. We need a focused effort to promote international trade. Address our liability climate. Kentucky, don't worry about all the facts on this. It just shows that Kentucky is out of step with our surrounding states in terms of tort reform. In other words, it's easier to get sued in Kentucky, whether you're an obstetrician or a nurse or a nursing home, you name it. We have not made that change. And it affects business decisions. We need to constantly be vigilant about red tape, trying to find ways in which we can look through our state government and find inefficiencies. We need to adapt to the changing energy landscape while preserving our heritage of coal and that tremendous resource. As somebody said, having our coal is like finding a bunch of cash in your basement. We have that resource, and as Mike Duncan showed, the world wants that coal. We've got to do that while being open. He said he was in the all of the above club, you know, whether it's solar, nuclear, whatever. We need to adapt and be cognizant of what new energy sources can mean to this state, just as Toyota is doing with their automobiles. Number two, build a sustainable government. What does that mean? That means you have enough money coming in that you can pay your bills. We're not there yet. As I mentioned, they passed a budget, but the teacher's retirement system was a lingering deficiency that was basically ignored. We need to aggressively manage the leaks. That's referring again to our leaky bucket report, and you have an update there where there has been some progress, but we've got to continue to do that. And it was three things: Medicaid, prisons, and public employee benefits. Those were the three main leaks. As we think ahead, pensions is the main issue. There's the update, and it has some specific recommendations in there of things that need to be done. In some cases, stay the course. In some cases, we've got to be more aggressive. Fix the state pension programs. I mentioned the teachers. We're going to come out with a proposal here in the next couple of months that we would like to introduce into the 2015 legislative discussion, where we require, the state would require more disclosure. You know, you'll have an actuarial say, well, everything's fine. Another actuarial say it's doomsday. And right now we don't have the checks and balances in Kentucky to figure that out. I don't have the expertise. I don't think people involved in making some of these decisions have the expertise. We met with two top legislators the other day and encouraged them, hire an expert. Bring somebody in here who can be a bulldog and ask these questions. Because it's billions of dollars, absolute billions of dollars. So we've got to work on pensions and stay focused on that. That's the biggest storm cloud on the horizon in Kentucky, I think, the pension situation. Prioritize investments in infrastructure, not just roads and bridges, but broadband and other things. We can't just allocate money to prisons and Medicaid and public employee benefits, and then whatever's left over, we say, okay, let's give some to schools and some to roads or whatever. We've got to prioritize investments, and that's not easily done. This is a picture of dormitories being built at UK. If any of you, some of you from UK, you've driven through the campus, it's amazing. And they're doing it with private money, private developers, without going to Frankfurt to beg for a pot of money. Undertake top-to-bottom management review. I happen to think this is low-hanging fruit for the next governor. Bring in McKinsey, bring in KPMG, Ernst & Young, somebody, and look at work rules, look at the seniority system, look at the personnel review. I tell you what, go find somebody that runs one of these departments in state government, take them out and buy them a refreshment, and get them talking about what they can do to manage their employees, some of whom have perhaps lost their gusto. It's frustrating. No business could do business that way. And so we need a top-to-bottom management review of how state government operates in a modern era. We don't want to penalize. You can't reward excellence in work in public employees because you've got these work rules. Like, well, everybody's the same as everybody. And I think it's time to break that mold. We have to concentrate on essential services. What does the state really need to do? And Paul talked about that just a minute ago a little bit too. This is the third main thing that I wanted to talk about: create a modern, well-trained workforce. We've heard a ton about that in the last day or two. What can we do? Here's, of the items that I'm listing, it's about, I think, 13, 14, 15 items in the presentation today. Of all the items to do, this is one not to do, okay? Let's don't back up on what we've already accomplished. There was a bill introduced this last time. I was there and testified, Senator Neal, you remember, with the teachers union. We don't always agree. We were there together with Dr. Holliday and said, let's don't back up. We have made progress. Kentucky was the first. Yeah, you can tweak it here and there, but it's new, tougher standards, and the business community needs that. We published this little report, Tougher Standards to Prepare Kentucky Students for College and Career. We said there are new standards, new tests, new scores, and the scores are going to be lower, and sure enough they were, but we've got to stay the course. And our teachers are really making that happen. And by the way, the surveys I've seen, teachers really like these new standards because they're understandable. We need to demand efficiency, accountability, and transparency. That can mean a lot of things. If the auditor, and Adam's going to be here in a little bit, if he goes into the Jefferson County schools and said you got too many administrators, we need to do something about that. We need to fix that. We need that kind of accountability and transparency. One way to do it in higher education funding would be to reward universities for graduating people rather than rewarding them just for how many people they've attracted to their campus to be enrolled. In other words, move toward a productivity scale of funding. We need to institute demand-driven worker training programs. You've heard a little bit about that. What does that mean? Demand means, what is the demand? What does a company like Toyota need in workforce training versus What are the programs that we offer every year, or that the federal government has said that we will offer in this state? Turn it around to where it's demand-driven. I think that's very important, and I think KCTCS has gone a long way in trying to do that. But more work, and Mike McCall would say, we have to do it this way. There's a worker training slide right there. Invest strategically in education and training. This was the chart we published in our 09 report. I won't go through the whole thing, but just left to right, those coins show how big the state economy had grown in 12 years. The bucket, how big the state government had grown in 12 years. Look at the next one, corrections, that's prisons, had grown faster. Look at Medicaid, taller. Look at public employee health care off the roof. And these are big dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars. And then P12-SEEK, that's your education funding. And P12 non-SEEK, that's stuff like textbooks and summer school and things like that. And I guess KET bill is in that coin chart. They just got hammered. And post-secondary education is out there on the right side in a weak showing. So we have to focus our spending on where we are really wanting to invest, when we would say in education and training. Let me show you this. Education funding hit a peak in 1986 to 88 budget. 48.2% of the state's budget was going into K-12. Now, 44.1. You say, well, okay, a few percentage points. Hundreds of millions of dollars makes a difference in whether or not you can buy new textbooks, whether or not teachers get a raise. Higher education, it's worse. 16.9% back in 86, 88, 11.6. They've just been hammered. The justification being, well, they can raise tuition, they can do this and that, and get by. And it's, you know, I don't mean to be facetious about that. It's tough decision-making in Frankfurt, but this is the result if we're not really careful in demanding that we invest in things that will cause us to be a better state. Now, address Kentucky's culture of dependency. Paul mentioned this a little bit. I think it's time to highlight this issue. The purple counties are the ones where there are more than 10% of the public that is on disability. The average in Kentucky is 8.2, twice the national average. And it's not just coal mining, but there are people on disability. They have found ways, and of course there are folks who will help you get there. I don't know why I put this in here. I just thought you might find it related. There are folks who will help you get on disability. And it's not just Eastern Kentucky, it's not just rural counties. There is a police and fire department in a city not too far from here where over 30% of the retirees somehow find a way onto disability in the last year or two before they retire. I think it's a scandal. I think it's absolutely a scandal. We've got to focus on that disability and to take nothing away from people who deserve the benefits that were intended when we set up a safety net for people who are truly injured in their work. We need to aggressively improve the health of our workforce. Study the other day, Wall Street Journal, less than one-third of I've forgotten the age cohort, 16 to 24, of our public would be eligible for physical, behavioral, or educational reasons to be in the U.S. military. Less than one-third of the public eligible to be in the military. And in Kentucky, a lot of it is physical wellness. We've been promoting the smoke-free. Kentucky will get that. It's just a matter of time. I'd hate to think we're going to be the last state to get that. And also, we need to incentivize workforce wellness programs. More companies have gotten involved in wellness. And I think that's a trend that we need to encourage. So the three major issues I've pointed out, that we've got to create a culture, a truly aggressive culture of competitiveness, a sustainable government, and a well-educated workforce. If I had to pick one, somebody asked Paul a question, what is the one thing, I think, Matt, you asked? Well-educated workforce. The other stuff will flow from that, I think. But that's where I think I would go. And by that, we can then, and by the way, back to the chess analogy. Each piece on the board has a move it can make, and we're going to have to move a lot of things. We can't just wait back for the next Toyota. We've got to continue to move things, and we can go from good to better to best. So, top issues facing the next governor. Actually, I wasn't very happy with that title when we got closer to the summit here. We do need to talk about the future and how we're going to make progress in these various areas, but I thought the better title for us in this room would be top issues facing us. What are we going to do? Everybody in this room has a role to play in making Kentucky a better one. We can't just wait for the next governor's race and say, oh, so-and-so ought to fix it. We've got to do our part through our own roles in our own communities to make Kentucky a better place. So, thanks very much.
Thanks,
are we out of time?
No.
A couple of questions,
if you have some comment or questions.
Or
to the microphone. Or not.
Or rebuttal. Okay, we got a great program coming up here on this next one. So let's take about a
15-minute break. Let's say 12 to 15 minutes and be back in here at 3 o'clock and we'll get the final session underway. Yeah.